Welcome to Midweek Space News. I'm going to go over some of the smaller space startups that have been in the news over the last week or so. So first of all, we have a X account. It's called at Space Startup Hub. So please follow us there for posts about the videos, upcoming videos, and videos I've released. You can find them on X and also various replies and stuff. So let's get into the first article this week. And this is on a company called Portal Space Systems. I've done a video on them already. This is when they came out of stealth. So this was last year, I think. They're working on solar thermal propulsion system. But there's some articles that have come out this week on the company. So let's have a look at that. This is from the Payload Space website. It's Portal Unveils Starburst and set for flight next year. So I've just highlighted some parts of the article. The startup has unveiled Starburst, which is for maneuvering payloads in orbit. It's designed to de-risk the thruster and rendezvous and proximity operation technology for their larger solar thermal propulsion technology. Customers were interested in smaller Starburst architecture. It was obvious that there was an interest in the customer community beyond just using it as our own risk reduction engine. And this is Jeff Thornburg, who's the CEO of Portal Space Systems. So this launch is on a transporter mission in Q4 2026, and it will help de-risk the more powerful solar thermal propulsion system called Supernova that will help move between orbits from low Earth orbit to geosynchronous orbit and so on. It has a much higher delta V than this demo satellite. They're still moving ahead with Supernova. It's just that it will leverage the systems tested and it will help to de-risk the first Starburst flight. It's definitely not a pivot away from Supernova, Thornburg said. It's completely synergistic with our tech supply chain and subsystems for Supernova. And the first flight of Supernova is in 2027, which is also the first flight of Portal's solar thermal propulsion system. I'm interested in this story more because of Supernova, the solar thermal propulsion system, rather than this tech demo. And certainly this will help de-risk the bigger system. So if you're not familiar with the Supernova system, it's two solar concentrators that concentrate the sun on a particular area on the craft, which has a heat exchanger, and that heats that heat exchanger to very high temperatures. And inside you have a fuel, probably ammonia, and later on just hydrogen. The fuel is heated and then is ejected out at the end of the vehicle as thrust. So there's no combustion. It's just heating up a fuel, which then generates thrust. And the hotter you can make the heat exchanger, the faster the fuel exits and the higher fuel efficiency you have and the more thrust you get. Ideally, you want to use hydrogen, but I think they're going to use ammonia first because it's just easier to deal with and it's $1 per kilo. And later on, you'd use hydrogen. The interesting thing is this is really a bridge technology towards nuclear thermal propulsion. So Supernova is solar thermal propulsion. The nuclear version would just switch the heat generation from the sun to a nuclear reactor. And then you have NTP, nuclear thermal propulsion. It's probably the fastest way to move around the solar system. You get to Mars in about a month with NTP. So this is a bridge technology that gets you halfway there. Here's an image of the heat exchangers. So you've got a small one here, and you've got a much bigger one here. So you have the fuel inside, and then you have the nozzle here. And basically, the solar concentrators would focus the sun very, very tightly on this heat exchanger. It would get very hot, and then the fuel would be expelled at the end to generate thrust. And another graphic we have here is giving you an idea of where it is in terms of fuel efficiency on the vertical axis, and on the horizontal axis, you have thrust. So the thrust is great. It's a lot better than ion thrusters. You can see it's much, much better than ion thrusters for maneuvering. It's a bit better than CubeSats, but in terms of like satellite chemical thrust, it's at the low end, and obviously much less raw thrust than you get from a second stage. This is like a Merlin vacuum second stage, it's a million newtons, and Portal's are like 50 to 200. Once you change the fuel to hydrogen, you can generate more heat from the heat exchanger. You could boost that up, and switching it to a nuclear reactor would boost it even further. But definitely, this is an interesting company to follow. The technology is very interesting. It's solar thermal propulsion hasn't been used in space before. It can generate something like 6 kilometers per second delta V. And all you need to do is refuel the ammonia tank in space. You could dock with it, refuel, and you've got another 6 kilometers per second delta V. and infinite restarts, unlike a chemical thruster. So you could just stay in space, keep refueling the tank, and each time you get 6 kilometers per second delta V. So it's a very interesting technology. Hopefully this demo mission will happen next year, and then I think 27, 28 will have the solar thermal propulsion engine. Okay, let's move on to the second story this week. And this was an article I found on the internet from the Relay. I'm not really familiar with the website, but this is an interesting article. It's called Commercial Moon Landings Grow Up in 2025, Blue Ghost and IM2, that's Intuitive Machines Mission 2. And it says revealed hard lessons in stability, power, and polar lighting. So the article says Firefly Aerospace's Blue Ghost touched down on the moon's near side and quickly moved into payload operations. So if you're not familiar with the Blue Ghost mission, I did a video on this. It was a 100% successful mission, and it's part of the CLPS program, that's Commercial Lunar Payload Services. This is NASA paying private space startups to build lunar landers to deploy NASA payloads to the lunar surface. It hasn't really been that successful in that only 1 out of 4 missions were completely successful. You could say Intuitive Mission 1 was partially successful, IM2 was a failure, and the astrobotic Peregrine lander couldn't make it out of Earth's orbit. It ended up crashing and burning up in the atmosphere. So only 1 out of 4, but these are quite cheap missions, and the companies are learning a lot, even if they don't succeed. So I think this is way forward, and I think Jared Isaacman will continue with Commercial Lunar Payload Services, and in fact extend it to Mars and beyond. They go on to say, on the 6th of March, and this is 2025, Intuitive Machines IM2 Athena reached the Mons Mouton region near the lunar south pole, but came to rest on its side inside a crater, cutting operations short. Well, the mission failed. I don't think anyone disagrees with that. I know Intuitive Machines said, well, we've got 30 seconds of data from some kind of Nokia payload. Basically, it was a failure. And IM1 was kind of 50% successful. They did get a lot of science data, but it did fall over. Together, they reset expectations for Artemis-era exploration. Move faster, aim harder. I agree with that. They say, in terms of what to do the next 12, 24 months, a tougher South Pole targeting stage by difficulty, define graded landing zones by slope, boulder density and sun elevation, and tie milestone payments to difficulty tiers, not just landing. If you go for a more difficult kind of terrain and succeed, you get paid a bigger amount. Tie milestone payments to difficulty tiers, not just landing. This article talks about lower center of gravity landing design. So I disagree with this, because this is getting very prescriptive. This is kind of an old space way of thinking. It's like NASA will decide exactly what the vehicle should look like and what the design should be, and they just pay a developer. That's old space. We don't want that. We want new space, which is, this is what NASA wants. This is the science. This is the payloads we want delivered. How it's done is entirely up to the private sector. So I'm against descriptive designs for private companies. NASA should have nothing to do with that, in my opinion. And it goes on about C2-4 small relay satellites in frozen polar orbits, with line of sight into key craters, and NASA's working on that. Intuitive Machines is working on lunar data relay satellites, so is Firefly Aerospace. NASA is working on a network of data relay satellites, ESA is with its Moonlight. I think JAXA is also building these kind of data relay satellites, and it's all put together in LunarNet, which is an interoperable set of standards that all the different satellites can communicate with each other. So that's a very good thing, and it is happening already. And they talk about equip relays with storage and forward for bursty science and simple ranging beacons for last mile navigation. Even a basic timing signal helps descent solutions converge. This is kind of PNT or position navigation and timing solutions via orbiting satellites or maybe even sensors on the ground. That will help with navigation and landing, which is a good thing. Then they talk about faster commercial lunar payload services cadence with deliberate risk. Fly more smaller missions, adopt block upgrades. Well, I'm definitely in favor of flying more often, having small missions. The problem is for an Artemis base camp, and this is going back to the video I did earlier this week with Impulse Space, there's a gap in the market. You have the very small missions, you have the very large human landing systems, and then you have nothing in the middle. So this is why Impulse Space is targeting the mid-tier, half a ton to 13 tons, because that's where a lot of the equipment you want for base camp exists. It's the habitats, it's the mining rigs, it's the power systems. All of that equipment, serious equipment, falls between two stools. You've got the very small CLPS missions, and you've got the very expensive billion-dollar human landing systems. So Impulse Space, I think, is absolutely right to target the middle area, which is underserved at the moment. Adopt block upgrades, I'm not really in favor of that. Again, I don't want anything that's prescriptive. NASA should just say, here's the science we want. Tell us where the lunar ice is, what the yields are, at what depth. That kind of information, don't tell the company how to do that. Let the companies innovate and come up with completely different designs on how to do it. Then you go and say, lower the cost of learning so the South Pole becomes routine by 2027. That sounds awesome. Consistent, precise landings within walking or rover range of targeted deposits. That sounds great. And near the craters with potential lunar water ice. Robust power polar day. So the lunar day is 14 days sunlight and 14 days of night. And the temperature swings are pretty extreme. So it's quite difficult to design something that can survive the lunar day and the lunar night. But it is required if we want a lunar economy. So that's something we should definitely work on. Stable platforms with low centers of gravity. Again, it's prescriptive. I don't agree with this. Let the private companies innovate. Intuitive Machines knows what center of gravity is. It's a very simple, basic concept. If they keep building landers that topple over, they will not succeed. I don't agree with having prescriptive lunar lander designs. Let the private companies innovate. And the ones that come up with good designs that land softly will succeed. Squat designs and wider legs need to be used. Nope, I disagree with that. Reward missions that take on harder polar sites, not just any soft landing. Yep. Tiered prizes, sounds good to me. Fund polar relay pathfinders that provide two-way links into shadow. Definitely communication around the craters is necessary because, for instance, Shackleton Crater is at a depth of 4 kilometers. So you won't be able to have good communication unless you figured out how to communicate with topside, with the habitats, with the rovers, and with the astronauts outside the crater. So it's absolutely critical we do that. Talking about 2027, Blue Ghost showed that a commercial lander can arrive, work, and wrap up on time. This is the existence proof that the commercial approach works. Blue Ghost, on the very first attempt, was 100% successful. It's the only one so far. Even in the case of Intuitive Machines, they're doing an IM-3, an IM-4, and I think they will succeed, maybe in the next landing attempt or so on. So I think they will succeed, and they're a lot cheaper than the cost-plus kind of designs. So let's keep continuing to give the commercial companies more missions, and they will eventually succeed, or they will leave the market. Simple. So that was interesting, and to go over some of the points, talks about PNT, or position, navigation, timing. Talked about, and I've done a video on Lunar Saber. This is a very tall mast, and then you can put 1 ton of payloads on the top. So communication, laser range finding, comms, imaging, and so on. And for instance, you can put these masts near the craters. They can communicate with equipment or people or rovers in the crater. And you can just put these Lunar Saber masts at different places around the South Pole, and they can all communicate with each other, so you can have this local area network. But you can also communicate with data relay satellites or direct Earth communication. So you've got full communications coverage of the whole South Pole just using these lunar masts. Power throughout the lunar day, the lunar day-night cycle, which is 14 days sun, 14 days no sun. So Honda and Astrobotic are teaming up. Astrobotic works on these VSATs, or vertical solar array towers. And Honda has a regenerative fuel cell technology system. So during the day when there's plenty of solar energy, you use extra energy to split water into hydrogen and oxygen. And then at lunar night, you can run it in reverse, combine hydrogen and oxygen to produce water and generate electricity. So you have electricity during the day and during the night. These two companies are working together, and this will give a full lunar day-night cycle power capability, which is what we need. So that's fantastic. I agree with the idea of moving quickly and breaking things or taking more risk. I definitely do not agree with a prescriptive approach to lunar landers. Just let the private companies innovate and they will either succeed or fail. Okay, on to our final story this week. Bring it up. And this is a game from Payload. It's Meet Diamondback, Gravitics new orbital carrier, and you can see it there on the screen. A small orbital carrier designed to fulfill missions from protecting US national security satellites to deploying space-based missile interceptors. Gravitics CEO Colin Doohan compared the company's tech to a police station, having police stations in key neighborhoods, complete with police cars that can quickly get to incidents. Because the assets are housed in Gravitics spacecraft, they are protected from thermal fluctuations, radiation, and micrometeorites, ensuring they're in prime condition when it's go time. The government can scale volumetrically with bigger carriers, or they can scale from a federated fleet perspective and quickly get an initial operating capability up in orbit that has global coverage. Gravitics was selected for a Space Force Stratify contract worth up to $60 million to build the tech for the Defense Department. If they're stationed throughout low Earth orbit and geosynchronous orbit, Gravitics spacecraft can reach any cislunar orbit in 12 hours and some locations in low Earth orbit in under 2 hours. And the idea is that this stops trouble before it happens. If an adversary spacecraft is preparing to attack a US military satellite, Gravitics craft could deploy a jammer or a dazzler. We become a high-capacity magazine for someone wanting to do space-based intercept. Civilian applications when minutes matter, such as staging emergency rescue tech or supplies for astronauts. Talking about rescuing astronauts, we had also recently orbital debris hit a Chinese capsule attached to the Tiangong space station. I don't think there's going to be any problems for the Chinese coming back, but it did show that the possibility that a spacecraft or a capsule could be damaged or destroyed, and then you've got a rescue mission you have to launch. So potentially having some kind of orbital carrier with extra food or oxygen or some kind of technology or equipment could be very useful in space. So it just reminded me of this, the space junk hitting the capsule. In terms of Gravitics, I've done various space news articles about them before. I've done various space news videos, but not a dedicated video on them. They have a number of module sizes, 4 meters, 6 meters, 8 meters. They're not a commercial space station operator. They build modules which they then sell to commercial space station operators. And they've already sold for $125 million a module to Axiom Space. Gravitics has announced today, and this is in 2024, they've been awarded a $125 million contract by Axiom Space to provide a pressurized spacecraft that will support Axiom Station operations. And I believe it was just to be some kind of warehouse or storage, so you don't need a lot of equipment in there. But they have a number of graphics showing their different modules. This is an orbital carrier module. You can see that the spacecraft inside. But in addition to that, they have various other modules they can build. This one is it's like pressurized, and you know, you've got habitation, you've got like logistics here, you've got computer systems. And they have another video here. We have a look at this one. These modules are built in the US. They're very basic modules. They can be pressurized, and then you can just launch them into space. They're designed to be purchased by commercial space operators for extra space, for instance. And here's another one, and this one is the logistics, extra supplies, which is probably what the Axiom Space module would be like. It'd be some kind of a logistics module. So if you got this far, you like the video, so please like and subscribe. I do these videos every week. In addition, I do two dedicated videos. I've done one already on Impulse Space, Lunar Lander, and then I'm going to do another video later this week, which will be on a moon theme, lunar infrastructure. And then I have a live stream over the weekend. Do that every single week. So I usually do 4 videos a week. So please like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.